Hello, my name is Bonnie Janicki, and I'm a Senior Grants Officer at the Corporation for National Community Service. To educate our grantees on how to complete the new Federal Financial Report, we've created an overview of the Federal Financial Report webinar and an FAQ that can be found at the Resource Center. If you have not reviewed the overview webinar and the FAQ, you should start there and then come back to this webinar. Today's webinar is really only a review of each of the fields on the Federal Financial Report. With that said, let's start with a very brief overview of the Federal Financial Report. The Federal Financial Report, also known as the FFR, issued by the Office of Management and Budget, also known as OMB, is a consolidated federal cash and federal expenditure report. It is replacing the financial status report that you submit to us and the federal cash transaction report that you submit to the payment management system. It also creates a government-wide standard for reporting periods and due dates. All reports, be it annual, semi-annual, or quarterly, will have a reporting period end date that falls on the end of a calendar quarter, and reports will be due 30 days after the reporting period ends. Federal agencies will have the option to specify which data elements from the FFR they want to require, but may not collect more than what appears on the form. Financial reports are a requirement of most corporation grants. The information submitted on these reports are used to monitor our grantees' financial progress. Reporting requirements, including reporting periods and frequency of submission, are established in the terms and conditions or provisions document which accompany each grant award. If you have any questions concerning the financial reporting requirements for your grant or the content of the financial report, please contact your assigned grants officer that you can find on your grant, and you can find your grants officer's name and telephone number on your notice of grant award. In accordance with the guidance from OMB, the corporation will continue to have you submit your expenditure data via eGrants and your cash transaction data via the payment management system. Although the actual FFR report will not look the same as the financial status report, the corporation has tried to keep the design of the FFR screens as close to the financial status report screens as possible. You will access the FFR in eGrants the same way you access the financial status report. eGrants will continue to display previously entered amounts and continue to calculate totals and percentages. The new FFR screens are now available in eGrants. Again, please note that you should continue to submit your cash transaction report the same as always. The payment management system plans on implementing their new form by October 1, 2009. Now we're going to move right into eGrants and begin reviewing each field. Like always, you will open eGrants and go to the Reporting to CNCS section on the homepage. Click on the Financial Report link. Find the report you're going to work with and click on Edit. We should now be moving to the General Information tab. This page contains basic information about the grant and FFR. Most of this information is automatically provided based on the data already entered into eGrants. However, you should review this information for accuracy before proceeding with the report. If at any time you have any questions about a field, you can click on the question mark and it will bring up our help text. You will see the question mark in various places throughout the screen. Now let's take a closer look at each field. The grant number field. This contains the grant number assigned by the corporation to identify your grant. Project name is the name of the project or program funded by the grant. The project name will appear as it was entered on your approved application's 424 face sheet. Grant year. This is the year under which the grant is operating. FFR number. This is the number that designates each FFR for a given grant year. In general, most grantees will have two FFRs for a given grant year. Reporting period start date. This is the first day of the reporting period for which data should be entered for this report. Reporting period end date. This is the last day of the reporting period for which financial data concerning your grant should be entered for this report. For reports marked final, the reporting period end date shall match the end date of the grant's project period. Due date. This is the date on which the report is due to the corporation. The financial report must be submitted on or before the due date to be considered on time. Extended due date. If the corporation has an approved an extension to the date on which the report is due, the new due date will appear here. In these cases, the financial report must be submitted on or before the extended due date to be considered on time. You must contact your assigned grants officer to request an extension of the FFR due date. Report type. This field indicates the frequency of FFR submissions, quarterly, semi-annual, or annual. Only the last FFR submitted for the grant should be marked as final. Consult your grant's reporting requirements in the Notice of Grant Award, Terms and Conditions or Provisions to determine which report type to enter. Basis of accounting. This is a method in which you record accounting transactions for the grant award. You can specify whether it's cash or accrual basis was used. An accrual basis of accounting refers to accounting method in which expenses are recorded when incurred. For a cash basis accounting, expenses are recorded when they are paid. And recipient account number or identifying number. This is an account number or any other identifying number assigned by you, the recipient, to the grant award. This number is for your use only and is not required by the corporation. Great. We've completed the first of three tabs. Let's move on to the next one, the FFR Transaction tab. On this page, you can enter and view expenditures and obligations incurred against the grant and report any excess program income. The cumulative total should reflect all data through the FFR's reporting period and date. To refresh calculations as you enter data, click on the Save button. Let me say that again. To refresh calculations as you enter data, click on the Save button. This screen is divided into four sections. There's the federal expenditures and unobligated balance. There's the recipient share. There's excess program income. And there's expenditure analysis. Let's now review each section. Federal expenditures and unobligated balance. In this section, you can view and enter data regarding the obligation of the federal share of grant funds. Total federal funds authorized. This field is the amount of federal funds awarded to date under this grant. But please note, this field is automatically calculated by eGrants. This total federal funds authorized should match the total corporation funds awarded to date from your most recent Notice of Grant Award. However, if your grant received a continuation funding in the middle of an FFR reporting period, the continuation funds may not be included in the total federal funds authorized field. These funds will appear on the next FFR. Federal share of expenditures. This is the amount of federal funds expended to date. The previously reported will auto-populate from your last financial report, and you will enter your current federal share of expenditures under this period. Federal share of unliquidated obligations. This field is the direct and indirect expenses incurred but not yet paid or charged to the grant, including amounts due to subrecipients and contractors. Unliquidated obligations should not include any amount that has been reported in the federal share of expenditures. Please note, for FFRs marked final, the unliquidated obligations field must be zero. Also, this field is sometimes overlooked and not completed. The corporation uses this field to determine if there is a need for a reduction of federal funds authorized and requires that it be completed at all times. Total federal share is simply the sum of the federal share of expenditures and the federal share of unliquidated obligations. Unobligated balance of federal funds is the difference between the total federal funds authorized and the total federal share. Okay, moving to the next section. Now for the recipient share. You can view and enter data regarding the expenditures of recipient share of grant, including all matching and cost sharing provided by you and third-party providers. Total recipient share required is the amount of recipient funds required by the corporation. This amount is based on your match or cost share percentage from your approved grant budget. Please note, this field is calculated by eGrants. As with the total federal funds authorized, if this grant received continuation funding in the middle of an FFR reporting period, the continuation funds may not be included in the total recipient share. These funds will appear on the next FFR. Recipient share of expenditures. This is the amount of actual cash disbursed or outlays, including payments to subrecipients and contractors. This amount may include the value of allowable third-party in-kind contributions and your share of program income used to finance the non-federal share of project or program. Again, previously reported will auto-populate from your last financial report, and you will enter your current recipient share of expenditures under this period. Please note, on the final report, this line should be equal to or greater than the total recipient share required. Remaining recipient share to be provided. This is the difference between the total recipient share required and the recipient share of expenditures. If the recipient share of expenditures is greater than the total recipient share required, zero will appear in this field. On to Section 3, Excess Program Income. Here, you can view and enter data regarding the disposition of any excess program income. You can report program income as expended in accordance with the deductive alternative or in accordance with the addition alternative, but not both. Do not include amounts already reported in the recipient share of expenditures. This section is for excess program income only. For further guidance on how to report program income for your grant, you should consult your grant terms and conditions or provisions. Also, there is a program income FAQ on the Resource Center to help address additional questions about program income. The total federal program income earned is the amount of program income earned under the grant not already reported in the recipient share of expenditures. Program income expended in accordance with the deductive alternative is the amount of program income which was used to reduce the federal share of total project cost. Program income expended in accordance with the addition alternative is the amount of program income which was added to the funds committed to the total program cost and expended to further eligible project activities. Unexpended program income is the difference between the total federal program income earned and the program income expended in accordance with the deductive alternative or the program income expended in accordance with the addition alternative. This amount equals the program income that has been earned but not expended as of the reporting period and date. Whew, now the final section of the expenditure analysis. This section is provided as a tool for you and the corporation to analyze expenditure data reported on your FFR. The data provided in the expenditure analysis field is calculated based on the expenditure and obligation amounts entered on the transaction page. Percentage of funds expended to date is the amount of federal and recipient funds expended as a percentage of the total federal funds authorized or the total required recipient share, respectively. Percentage share of total expenditures is the amount of federal recipient funds expended as a percentage of the total reported expenditures, federal plus recipient share for the grant. Percentage of federal funds unobligated is the amount of unobligated balance of federal funds as a percentage of the total federal funds authorized. Great, we're almost finished reviewing the FFR. Let's move to the final tab. We'll move to the FFR Certification and Submit page. This page contains an area to record additional comments to be included with the transaction data and the tools to approve and submit your FFR. You can also view and print the FFR prior to submitting your report to the corporation. This page is divided into three small sections. Certification. Here you will certify that the report is true, complete, and accurate to the best of your knowledge. By clicking on the I agree button, eGrants will record the name of the person certifying the report and the date on which the certification is complete. The FFR must be certified before it can be submitted. Only persons authorized by your organization to submit financial data should certify the FFR. Remarks section. In this section, any additional comments or explanations regarding the data on the transaction screen should be entered here. And finally, the available actions. You can view or print the FFR in PDF format by just clicking on this link. Please note, if you view the FFR before submitting it to the corporation, the word draft will appear at the top of the report as an indication that the date entered on the report is not yet final. Once a report is submitted to the corporation, the word draft will no longer appear on the print version of the report. Submit financial report. Click on this link to officially submit the FFR to the corporation. The name of the person submitting the report and the date on which it is submitted will be recorded in eGrants. Once the report is submitted, you will only be able to review the report in PDF and will not be able to edit any of the information recorded on the report. If additional edits are required, you will need to contact your assigned grants officer and ask them to return the report to you. We've now reviewed each of the fields on the FFR, and this concludes our presentation for today. As I mentioned in the introduction of this webinar, there is also an overview and an FAQ on the Resource Center as well. Thank you so much for your time, and remember to always submit your reports on or before the due date.